أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إنا نحن نزلنا عليك القرآن تنزيلا فاصبر لحكم ربك ولا تطع منهم آثما أو كفورا واذكر اسم ربك بكرة وأصيلا ومن الليل فاسجد له وسبح ليلا طويلا إن هؤلاء يحبون العاجلة ويذرون وراءهم يوما ثقيلا نحن خلقناهم وشددنا أسرهم وإذا شئنا بدلنا أمثالهم تبديلا إن هذه تذكرة فمن شاء اتخذ إلى ربه سبيلا وما تشاءون إلا أن يشاء الله إن الله كان عليما حكيما يدخل من يشاء في رحمته والظالمين أعد لهم عذابا أليما. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وإمام المرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقائدنا وقرة عيننا محمد بن عبد الله عليه وعلى آله الطيبين وأصحابه الغر الميامين أفضل الصلاة وتم التسليم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. After praising Allah جل في علاه and sending salutations upon our messenger Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام we proceed. And alhamdulillah that Allah تبارك وتعالى has gathered us here this evening once again. Continuing in our series that we had started on the history of Islam. And we have covered in our previous sessions the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ briefly, the khilaf of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, the khilaf of Umar radiallahu anhu, the khilaf of Uthman radiallahu anhu, and the khilaf of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu arda. And last session we also covered the khilaf of Al-Hasan ibn Ali radiallahu anhu arda, and how he stepped down from the Khilafah in order to unite the Muslims in the 40th year after Hijrah, known as Aam al-Jama'ah, the year of unity. Where Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan radiallahu anhu was the Khalifa. And the agreement between Al-Hasan ibn Ali and Muawiyah was that Muawiyah will be the Khalifa and Al-Hasan will be Khalifa after him. But Hassan radiallahu anhu passed away before that could happen. Muawiyah radiallahu anhu was the first king of Islam. He's known as the first king of Islam. And he ruled for a long period of time, 20 years. He was Khalifa for 20 years. Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, all of those who spoke about him, they only had good things to say about him. Abdullah ibn Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhuma, he would say, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا, I have not seen anyone أَسْوَدْ بَعْدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ مُعَاوِيَ بَنْ أَبِي سُفْيَانَ. He said, I have not seen anyone who is more suitable for leadership and to be a great leader and who is good at doing this job after the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam than Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. And then he was asked, radiallahu anhu arda'ah, what about Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali? He said, they are better and they are more virtuous. But Muawiyah was better at siyasa than them. And Imam al-Dhahibi rahmatullahi alayhi mentions, when he talks about Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, he says that he was the most forbearing, known for his hilm, to the extent that a man, he uttered some unacceptable statements in the presence of Muawiyah. And Muawiyah radiallahu anhu did not get angry, even though he's in a position of authority and power, he has the power to do so. But he said in response to that, that I do not want the mistake that he made to be greater than my forbearance and my patience. He was known for that, forgiving. And Imam al-Dhahibi rahmatullahi alayhi narrates that the Sahaba that lived in the time of Muawiyah, al-Hasan, al-Husayn, al-Hasan, and Abdullah ibn Zubayr, Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abbas, and so on. Many of them, he would honor them. Whenever they would come to Dimashq, to Damascus, he would honor them. And he would give them a lot of ataya, gifts, because he would honor the Sahaba of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. And Muawiyah radiallahu anhu was one of the most knowledgeable Sahaba, to the extent that Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said about him, huwa min fuqaha'i Sahaba, he's from the fuqaha, those who are knowledgeable, the scholars of the Sahaba. And he also said, it is said about him that when Abdullah ibn Umar came to Dimashq, he said that I have not seen anyone whose prayer is more similar to the prayer of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam min amirikum hadha, ay Muawiyah. His salah was like the salah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And he was a righteous man. Khalil al-Mu'mineen, he was known as the maternal uncle of the believers. Why? Because his sister Ramla, Habiba radiallahu anha, she was al-Mu'mineen, the mother of the believers, the wife of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And he was min katabat al-wahi, those who used to write the wahi for the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. When Muawiyah was chosen as Khalifa, all of the Muslims gave him bay'ah. They were content with him. They were pleased with him as their leader. And he came to, after Al-Hassan stepped down, he came to Iraq. And Al-Hassan and Ali and Al-Husayn, they both gave him bay'ah. And the rest of the people of Iraq gave him bay'ah. And the rest of the lands of the Muslims gave him bay'ah. And Imam al-Dhahibi rahmatullahi alayhi says that Muawiyah, he was one of the only men that Abu Bakr, Umar, and Uthman, they were pleased with and happy with to be a governor. Whereas other governors were always removed and replaced. Especially he mentions Umar, because Umar was very harsh with his governors. But he kept Muawiyah in place. And Uthman radiallahu anhu kept him in place. And the people of Sham loved him. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum would say about Muawiyah that we have not seen anyone who is more suitable for the position of Khilafah than Muawiyah radiallahu anhu arda. In the time of Muawiyah, a lot of justice spread. He was very just. There was no oppression in the Muslim lands. And the people were very well off, the Muslims. And the Futuhat carried on, the conquest to open the Muslim other lands, carried on in the time of Muawiyah. Al-A'mash, who was from the ulama, the tabi'een, he was asked, who is better, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz or Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan? Al-A'mash, he responded harshly, because he was known for his harshness. So his name is Sulaiman ibn Mahran Al-A'mash. He responded harshly, the dust that Muawiyah, that comes out of Muawiyah, it is better than Umar ibn Aziz altogether. Why? Because Muawiyah is the companion of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. He prayed behind the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. He wrote the wahi for the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. He said there's no comparison. And he said that people, they praise Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, and he deserves praise. But he is nowhere near the rank of Muawiyah, and the time of Muawiyah was a lot better than the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. That's what A'mash is. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, he is considered the fifth Khalifa al-Rashida. But the ulama of the Salaf considered Muawiyah radiallahu anhu the true Khalifa al-Rashida, al-Khamis, the fifth. Because of how just he was and how fair he was, and his status with the Messenger alayhi salatu wa sallam and the Sahaba. Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, during his reign, he organized the Islamic State even more, and he became even stronger in his time. Towards the end of his reign, he was afraid of fitna occurring again. He was afraid of the fitna that happened in the time of Uthman, after the killing of Uthman radiallahu anhu, and in the time of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, to repeat itself. He wanted to avoid that at all costs. So he had an idea. And he was a mujtahid. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he says about him that Muawiyah kana mujtahidan min mujtahidin al-sahaba. He said that because of the knowledge he possessed, he did ijtihad to come to conclusion, Islamic conclusion, because of the fiqh that he had, radiallahu anhu arda. So he came to conclusion that he is going to nominate the next Khalifa in order to avoid fitnah. And not only that, but he is going to get the bay'ah from the Muslims for the next Khalifa whilst he's alive, to make sure that they obey him after he passes away. He did all of that to protect the blood of the Muslims from being shed. So he, radiallahu anhu, what did he do? He nominated his son Yazid ibn Muawiyah as the next Khalifa. So what did he do, Muawiyah? He went to the different lands, the Sham. The people of Sham gave bay'ah. And then he went to all the other lands, he got bay'ah from them. Then he went to Medina. And he spoke to the Sahaba who are in Medina. The Sahaba in Medina, when they heard this, that Muawiyah is trying to get bay'ah for his son Yazid, they rejected this. Amongst them is Al-Husayn ibn Ali, Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, Abdullah ibn Abbas. They all rejected this. And they said that, Muawiyah, you have gone against the tradition of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, which is that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said that the khilafah it is shura bayn al-muslimin. The Muslims, they consult each other and they pick their leader. Not wiratha. It is not inherited, the khilafah. So they rejected this. But Muawiyah insisted that they gave bay'ah to Yazid. So what happened? When they heard, before Muawiyah came to Medina, Marwan al-Hakim, who's in Medina, he delivered a letter from Muawiyah, a speech about the intentions of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu before he had come to Medina. So Al-Husayn ibn Ali, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, they left Medina, they went to Mecca to avoid Muawiyah. They don't want to have any altercations with the Khalifa, and they don't want to disobey him, so they want to avoid him. Muawiyah came, he heard, he got bay'ah from the people of Medina for Yazid. And then he went after Al-Husayn, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abbas in Mecca. He went after them. He managed to catch up to Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abbas. As for Al-Husayn ibn Ali and Abdullah ibn Zubayr, they did not have an encounter with Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. When he came to Mecca, he spoke to Abdullah ibn Umar and Abdullah ibn Abbas. And they both said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, we cannot give bay'ah to Yazid. This is going to start a new tradition that it's against the guidance of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. Muawiyah insisted. He said to Abdullah ibn Umar, Ya Abdullah, are you going to give bay'ah to Yazid? Abdullah ibn Umar was a person who disliked fitnah, didn't like to get involved in it. So he responded by saying that if the Muslims give bay'ah to Yazid, I am one of the Muslims. And if they all give bay'ah to him, I'll give bay'ah, no problem. As for now, no. Muawiyah kept insisting, but Abdullah ibn Umar kept repeating the same answer. When he realized that he's not budging, he took his word for it and left him. And fi'lan, after the death of Muawiyah, Abdullah ibn Umar gave bay'ah to Yazid. Because the Muslims gave bay'ah to Yazid. As for Abdullah ibn Abbas, when Muawiyah said to him, give bay'ah to Yazid, he said, I'm not giving bay'ah to Yazid. He said, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, that there are no two khalifas at the same time. If there are two khalifas at the same time, kill one of them. You are the khalifa now. I can't give bay'ah to Yazid because you will be khalifa as well at the same time as you. That's not possible. The Messenger alayhi salatu told us not to do that. He said, when I pass away, you're going to give bay'ah to Yazid. He said, I'm one of the Muslims. I do what the Muslims do. So Abdullah ibn Abbas and Abdullah ibn Umar gave a similar answer. And fi'lan, after the Muawiyah radiallahu anhu passed away, they gave bay'ah to Yazid because they avoided fitnah. As for al-Husayn, his position was very clear. He did not see Yazid to be befitting for the Khilafah, number one. Secondly, he did not see it to be right to give bay'ah to Yazid, so he never did. And Abdullah ibn Zubayr was similar. They had the same stance. And they never gave bay'ah to Yazid, even after the death of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu wa arda. They remained in Mecca during that time. Muawiyah radiallahu anhu passed away. Yazid ibn Muawiyah became the Khalifa. Now some of that must be mentioned. It is that Yazid, he's not a Sahabi, he's a Tabi'i. He's not a companion of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. He's a Tabi'i. The Tabi'in are the generation after Sahaba. The definition of a Tabi'i is someone who met the Sahaba of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, or a Sahabi, and he was Muslim, and he died in the state of Islam. That's the definition of a Tabi'i. So Yazid was a Tabi'i. Yazid ibn Muawiyah, he became Khalifa. When he became Khalifa, he saw al-Husayn ibn Ali and Abdullah ibn Zubayr as a threat. But he never did anything about it, initially. Because he was aware that they never gave him bay'ah. So he was afraid that they would seek khilafah for themselves. But at the beginning, he didn't do anything about it. Time went on. And Yazid started hearing rumors that the people of Medina are rejecting his khilafah. And there was a man in Medina, his name is Abdullah ibn Muti'. He was one of the first to call the people of Medina to reject the Khilafah of Yazid and to rebel. A lot of the people of Medina followed him. But Abdullah ibn Umar was in Medina at the time. He spoke to Abdullah ibn Muti', he said to him, what are you doing, Ibn Am? Oh my cousin, what are you doing? He said, we are rebelling against Yazid. Yazid is one who is not suitable for the Khilafah. Rather, he does things that goes against the deen of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, and he does not make the Quran his primary source of judgment. That's what he said. Abdullah ibn Umar, he said to him, what you're doing is wrong. What you're doing is treachery. Khiyana, he said to them. You have given bay'ah to the Khalifa, you cannot take that back, he said to them. And he's one who disliked fitna so much. He said, spare the blood of the Muslims. Don't rebel against the Khalifa. Abdullah ibn Muti' refused to listen to Abdullah ibn Umar. Abdullah ibn Umar, he isolated himself from this fitna with his family. Yazid, now he hears that the people of Medina are rebelling. What does he do? He sends Nu'man al-Bashir radiallahu anhu, Sahabi, to Medina from Sham to go talk some sense into them. Nu'man al-Bashir comes to Medina. He tells the people of Medina, what you're doing is wrong. Obey the Khalifa. Do not rebel. It's going to have severe consequences. A lot of them do not listen. And he didn't manage to convince him radiallahu anhu wa arda. Amongst the people of Medina was Muhammad ibn Sirin, who isolated himself from the fitna of the people of Medina, rebelling against Yazid. And he told them, what are you doing is incorrect. Rather, Muhammad ibn Sirin would spend his time in the masjid. He would not sit with them. He would not go to their meetings discussing this and so on. Also, amongst the people who tried to convince them to not rebel was Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib, who knows Muhammad al-Hanafiyya, ibn al-Hanafiyya. He told them that Yazid, he is a legitimate ruler. Whether you like him or not, he's a legitimate ruler. And we have seen years of fitna before this. If you are to rebel or people of Medina now and turn against him, the blood of the Muslim is going to be spilt all over Medina, and you are going to be the reason for that. They didn't listen to him. So Yazid, he sent a man known as Muslim ibn Uqba al-Marri with an army heading towards Medina to either force them to obey him or to fight them. Muslim, he went to Medina, and the people of Medina were refusing to obey Yazid. So what did he do? He fought them and he killed them. And this is known as Waqatul Harra, where a lot of the Sahaba were killed. Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi mentions that 700 Hamalat al-Qur'an were killed in Waqat al-Harra. 700. Just carriers of the Qur'an. Hundreds of people were killed in that fitna. And Imam Malik, he mentions some of them were Sahaba. A number of them were the companions of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, who killed. After Muslim ibn Uqba, he killed those Sahaba in Medina. No Medina now, it's haram. Istahallaha, he made it halal to fight, which is something that is prohibited. And then he went on to Mecca, because the people of Mecca, who's there? Abdullah ibn Zubayr, who's also not given bay'ah to Yazid. And the people of Mecca also followed his example. So what did he do? He surrounded, Muslim al-Uqba surrounded Mecca, and he cut off all the water coming to Mecca, no food supplies, nothing. And he also catapulted the Kaaba, a part of it broke. Kaaba was catapulted twice in Islamic history. The first man to do was Muslim ibn Uqba. The second man to do it was Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf Thaqafi. He surrounded the people of Mecca. Abdullah ibn Zubayr is there. And there's a siege. No one can get out, no one can get in. It remained for a long period of time. Carried on for a long period of time. Until Yazid passed away, and then the siege ended. This is one of the things that is mentioned, that Imam al-Dhahibi rahmatullahi alayhi mentions, and he says that it's part of the dark history of Yazid. It's filled his, the pages of his record, it's the black pages in his history, he says. Also, before this, Al-Husayn ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu warda, he's in Mecca. The people of Iraq, they would send letters to Al-Husayn, telling him that they see him as the rightful Khalifa, and that Yazid is not the rightful Khalifa, and that they are willing to support him and give him bay'ah, telling him to come to Kufa, Iraq. Al-Husayn, he didn't believe it at first. He consulted some of the people with him, like Abdullah ibn Zubayr, Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abbas. They said to him, these people of Kufa are the same people who killed your father. They are people who are full of deception and khiyana. Don't believe a word they say. So Al-Husayn, bearing that in mind, he sent his cousin Muslim ibn Aqil to Kufa to go find out if this is true. Muslim Aqil, he went to Kufa, and he found out that the people of Kufa are genuine. that they are genuinely supporting Al-Husayn. So Muslim, he sent letters to Al-Husayn and Ali telling him that what I have found in Kufa, it is exactly what they wrote their letters. They are all supporting you. Yazid ibn Muawiyah, he heard about this, heard some rumors, he wasn't sure. And he saw Al-Husayn as a threat, as I mentioned at the beginning. So what did he do? He made the governor of Basra at the time to also be the governor of Kufa. Who was this man? His name was Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad ibn Abi. Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad was a tyrant. He was governing Basra and Kufa together. Yazid ibn Muawiyah told Ubaydullah, do whatever it takes to stop Al-Husayn. That's what he said to him. Whatever it takes. That's the orders that he has from Yazid. Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad, he comes to Kufa. And the first thing he does as the governor of Kufa, it is to threaten the people of Kufa and to scare them and to frighten them. So what did he do? He hunted Muslim ibn Aqil and some of their tribal leaders, and he killed them, he crucified them and kept them hanging in the streets of Kufa for everyone to see. When that happened, all of the people of Kufa, except a few, stopped supporting Al-Husayn. They were terrified. Amongst the people of Kufa were some men who were evil, who were turning Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad against Al-Husayn even more. And the worst of them was a man known as Shamr ibn Dhul-Jawshan. He will tell Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad to be harsh against Al-Husayn. Al-Husayn ibn Ali radiallahu anhu, he was heading towards Kufa with his family. Halfway, on the way there, he receives messages that the people of Kufa have betrayed him, and they turned against him. So Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu, he gets to a place called Karbala and he camps there in Iraq. Whilst he's in Karbala, Shamar, this evil man, he's telling Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad, the only way that you can stop Al-Husayn is by killing him. So he influenced Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. What did Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad do? He sent Umar ibn Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas, who was the leader and the general of his army, to head out to meet Al-Husayn in Karbala. Initially, when Umar sent, he went out to meet Husayn, his goal was only to turn Husayn away. Tell him, leave. Don't come towards Iraq. Go back where you came from, we'll leave you. Because Umar did not want to get involved in this fitna. But Shamar, he's telling Ubaydullah Ziyad, the only way that you can end it is by telling Umar he has to fight him and kill him. So Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad, he summons Umar ibn Sa'ad and he says to him that I give you orders that you fight Husayn. So Umar refuses. Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad threatens him and says to him that if you don't do what I tell you to do, I'm going to strip you of all the authority that you have. You're going to lose everything. I'm going to make you the worst of the worst. He threatened him. So Umar ibn Sa'ad, he obeyed Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad for worldly gain. And he went out with his army, hesitantly. And then when he went out, Shamar followed him. And he made sure that he fulfilled the commands of Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. Whilst Umar was hesitant, Shamar said to him, if you don't do it, I'm going to take over and lead the army. So Umar felt like he was being undermined. So what did he do? It ignited in him that fire of, I have to show that I'm the one who's in charge here, not Shamar. So he fought against Al-Husayn ibn Ali, and they killed a number of his family. And Shamar the Khabith, He is the one who killed Al-Husayn ibn Ali radiallahu anhu and cut off his head in Karbala. This happened Muharram, the 10th of Muharram, Yom Ashura. They brought the head of Al-Husayn to Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad, this evil man, he started playing with Hussein's face and his teeth in front of those who are in front of him. And amongst those who are present was Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, who was very old in age at this time. And another Sahabi known as Abdullah ibn Harith. When Abdullah came in, he told Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad, "You are an evil man, what you're doing is evil. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is going to hold you accountable yawm al-qiyamah and he's going to punish you severely." When he said that to him, Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad, he responded by saying to him that you are from the low Sahaba of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. Imagine. And then Abdullah, he said to him, and the companions of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, amongst them are there those who are low? After Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu was martyred, news got to Yazid and Muawiyah. It is said in the narrations that Yazid, he cried when Al-Husayn was killed. And he cursed and insulted Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. But that doesn't mean that he had nothing to do with it. Because he's the one who made Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad the governor and told him to do whatever it takes to stop Al-Husayn. He may not have directly ordered the killing of Al-Husayn, which is true. But he is responsible as well. It happened under his watch. He didn't stop it, even though he knew that things were escalating. He was getting news from Iraq that things were escalating with Hussein, but he didn't stop it. It is said that the family of Hussein, they came to Al-Sham, where Yazid was, and he honored them. And he kept them in Sham, and he gave them places to live, and he gave them an allowance. But that still doesn't make up what he did. Imam al-Dhahabi rahmatullahi alayhi mentions, and he says that about Yazid, Imam al-Dhahabi was a very just man, very fair. And even with those who committed the worst atrocities, he was very fair with them. He said about Yazid and Muawiyah that لَهُ حَسَنَاتِ, he had some good that he has done, but is swimming in bad deeds because of وَقَعَةُ الْحَرَّةِ and the killing of Hussein, and also surrounding Mecca and catapulting the Kaaba. All this happened under his command. But on top of that, there are some narrations that say about Yazid that he was evil and that he used to do things that were haram, disobedience, acts of disobedience, fisq. When Abdullah ibn Muti'i, he decided to rebel against Yazid, he said to Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib, Muhammad ibn Hanafiyyah, that Yazid, he is an evil man, fasiq. He said that he does not pray the salah, and he drinks alcohol, and he does not rule by the book of Allah, tabarak wa ta'ala, rather he abandons it. Muhammad ibn Hanafiyyah, he said, I went to Sham, and I stayed with Yazid, and all I saw from him is that he was one who was keen to pray the prayer. And he never did anything that was fisq. And he never did anything that was known as evil. And those narrations about him drinking alcohol, those things, none of them are authentic. A lot of them are fabricated, to be fair. Because of certain people who, their hatred they have for Yazid, they fabricate a lot of lies about him to make him look even worse than he already does. And as Muslimin, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says to us, وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ شَنَآنُ قَوْمٍ عَلَىٰ أَنْ لَا تَعْدِلُوا اِعْدِلُهُ أَقْرَبُ لِلتَّقْوَىٰ. Don't let the hatred that you have for a people make you unjust. Be just, that is close to taqwa. You have to be just in your statements and everything that you do. After Yazid ibn Muawiyah passed away, he had one son known as Muawiyah ibn Yazid. His son became the Khalifa after him, who was in his 20s at the time. And his son only ruled for a short period of time. After his son, He ruled for about 2 years, he said. Then he died. And he left no children. So what happened after that? Bani Umayyah had a constitutional crisis where they had no Khalifa, no heir to the throne. So there was a Tabi, his name was Marwan al-Hakam. He was the one who saved the dynasty of Bani Umayyah. He became the next Khalifa. And this is where the next family tree of Bani Umayyah comes from Marwan ibn al-Hakam. Those who come from Muawiyah end with Muawiyah ibn Yazid. Marwan ibn al-Hakam became the Khalifa. And he only ruled Sham and Iraq and Egypt at that time. When there was no Khalifa after Muawiyah ibn Yazid, Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhu was in Mecca, he declared himself Khalifa and the people gave him bay'ah. So now there was two states at the times, at that time. Bani Umayyah and the Zubayriyin, who were in Hijaz. Abdullah ibn Zubayr, he was ruling all of Hijaz, Mecca, Medina, Ta'if, all that area. And then he also managed to capture Iraq. And he made his brother Mus'ab ibn Zubayr the governor of Iraq. And he also managed to capture Egypt. So he was ruling more than Marwan al-Hakam. Marwan tried during his time to take back these lands, but he didn't succeed. And he passed away before he was able to accomplish that. And then his son succeeded him, Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, rahmatullahi alayhi. Abdul Malik ibn Marwan was a scholar, a faqih, very knowledgeable. But also, he was very good at siyasa, politics. He knew how to govern very well. And he knew the right people to bring or keep close to him in order to succeed in what he wanted to accomplish. So Abdul Malik Marwan, his first mission is to get back the land that he lost to Abdullah ibn Zubayr. So the Zubayriyin and Bani Umayyah, they are fighting. And there was a number of battles that happened between them. However, it never led to anyone being the official victor and capturing lands from the other. But it went back and forth numerous times. And Abdullah ibn Zubayr was strong in Mecca. But Abdullah ibn Zubayr, the Sahabi al-Jalil radiallahu anhu, he was a man who was a zahid, extremely detached from the dunya. He did not want anything from the beauty of the dunya, the adornments of the dunya. Rather, he was one who preoccupied himself with ibadah. And he wore very simple clothes. And he would not take any wealth from the Muslims. Lived a very simple life. Spent a lot of his time in the haram praying to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. To the extent that when he would be praying, he would pray for so long and he would be in certain position for so long that the birds, they would rest on his head and they wouldn't move. Because he would be in position for so long. Radiallahu anhuma. So what happened? There was a battle that happened between Bani Umayyah and the Zubayriyin. In this battle emerged a man who is going to play a huge role in Bani Umayyah recapturing the lands they lost. This is a man known as Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi. Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi is from Bani Thaqif, who were from Ta'if. He lived in Ta'if. He was a Quran teacher in Ta'if. He used to teach Quran. Al-Hajjaj, when he was in Ta'if, he used to teach the children Quran, and he was known for that. When Abdullah ibn Zubayr was fighting against Bani Umayyah, he joined the army and he fought alongside Abdullah ibn Zubayr. And he was very courageous and he was very good at fighting. He thought that if he fought very well, that he would get something in the Zubayri government, a position or something like that. He got nothing. Because Abdullah ibn Zubayr, his government was very simple. There was no lofty position and so on. When Hajjaj, he saw that, he decided to look for position elsewhere. He went to Sham, to Dimashq, to get close to Bani Umayyah, to seek a position from them. The first thing he did was he joined the police. And then when he joined the police, he started to shine being a police officer. And he outshined the commander of the police. Abd al-Malik al-Marwan noticed that. So what did he do? He made al-Hajjaj the commander of the police. This is when he started to make his way up the ranks. Al-Hajjaj started becoming very close to Abd al-Malik al-Marwan. And Abd al-Malik al-Marwan realized this man is very loyal. And he would do whatever he asked him to do. If he told him to jump, he would say, how high? Without questioning his authority ever. Al-Hajjaj, when he's described, they described him as a very ugly man. Very short. And he had a very short temper. And he was one who used to get angry about the smallest things. And he was oppressive. He would spill blood easily. Killing was second nature to him. It didn't mean much to him, spilling the blood of people. Also, he was one who used to be very envious of people. He says that about himself. And he was very ambitious. But on top of that, he was a man who never ever lied. Never ever missed Salatul Jama'ah. He used to finish the Quran every week. He used to give a lot of sadaqah. So very bipolar. And on one side, he's doing all sorts of evil. On the other side, he's doing so many righteous deeds. And that's why he confused a lot of people. They didn't know what to say about him. The ulama even differed on what to say about him. Is he Muslim? Is he non-Muslim? Or is he fasiq? And so on. So Al-Hajjaj, he was also very eloquent. When he was in Sham, Abd al-Malik al-Marwan sent him on his first huge mission. And this is where Hajjaj's life changes. He sends him to Iraq with an army. And he told him to lead that army to recapture Iraq. Who was in Iraq? Mus'ab ibn Zubayr, the brother Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Abd al-Malik Marwan told him to recapture Iraq. So, Al-Hajjaj, he succeeds. And he actually kills Mus'ab ibn Zubayr. And he cuts off his head. And he brings his head to Abd al-Malik Marwan. Abd al-Malik Marwan, he was freaked out by that when he brought his head. And he said to him, you could have obeyed me without doing that. Right? He said, you went too far. But Al-Hajjaj, he said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, I had to make sure that I showed you that I had done the job and it was finished. That's why I brought his head. After that, Al-Hajjaj was appointed as the governor of Iraq by Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan, as a reward. When he was in Iraq, he managed to keep the people of Iraq behaving because they were known for rebelling. And the famous incident that happened is when he entered Kufa. Kufa has a lot of history, we've mentioned this before. That they used to rebel against their leaders. They used to reject every leader that comes from governor. They used to complain about their governors constantly to their khulafa. So when Hajjaj went there, he knows about them. He went there and he went into the masjid of Kufa, the big masjid of Kufa. And the people of Kufa, they see a man whose face is covered. He has his face covered. Who's very short, who enters the masjid. So they are thinking, this is the man who's going to govern us. They start to belittle him. So Hajjaj, when he realized that they were belittling him and some of them were actually throwing pebbles towards his direction, and the pebbles were on the floor, he ascended the pulpit and his face is still covered. All they can see is his eyes. Then he had his guards with him. He told the guard to read the letter from the Khalifa. He read the letter. When he read the letter, he started with the salam. That the Khalifa sing salam to them. From Amir al-Mu'minin Abdul-Malik al-Marwan to the people of Kufa, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. All the people of Kufa, no one responded. They're sitting there silently. Hajjaj, he screamed, shouted. He said, "Wa'ihakum." He said, Amir al-Mu'minin gives you salam and you don't respond. Wallahi, law addibannakum ghayra hadha al-adab. He said, I'm going to discipline you other than this discipline. I'm going to make sure that you behave, that I put you in line. He told the guard, repeat the letter, the salam. He started again with the salam. They said, wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Now they're scared. He read the letter. After he read the letter, Hajjaj uncovered his face. They saw his face, they were terrified. Because he didn't look good. And then he started to speak, and he was a very eloquent man. To the extent that ulama, they say that Hajjaj was from the four amongst the Arabs who never ever did lahan, never made a grammatical mistake speaking Arabic. Very eloquent. He started his sermon. He said, Ya Ahla Kufa, Ya Ahla al-Fisqi wal-Nifaq, O people of Kufa, the people of hypocrisy, who are known for the hypocrisy and the nifaq and fisq. He said, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, has sent me to you as your governor. And he has also told me to inform you that all the men amongst you, they must join my army. And he said, Amir al-Mu'mineen, he gave me before I left Sham two swords, a sword of rahmah and a sword of niqmah, punishment. He said, when I was on the way, I lost one of the swords and I only have the sword of punishment. He said, Ya Ahla Kufa, I see heads that have become ripe. And the time of plucking has come. And wallahi, I'm going to be the one that plucks them. When he said that, they said, wow, this guy is not joking. Right? And they had heard about him, but they didn't think that he was this bad. So, and he actually made an example of some of the men of Kufa after his sermon by killing them immediately, because they were criminals. Amongst them was one of the one men who killed Uthman bin Affan, who took part in the killing of Uthman bin Affan. So what did he do? He went out the masjid. And as soon as he left the masjid, he was approached by an old man. This old man said to him, Ya Amir, Rahimallahu al-Amir, may Allah have mercy upon the Amir. I am an old man, I cannot join the army. Take my son instead, I have no strength. He said to him, you're useless anyway, we'll take your son, go away. As he turned away, Hajjaj was told, you know who that is? That's man who took part in the killing of Uthman bin Affan radiallahu anhu. Hajjaj, he turned around immediately, he took out his sword, he said to him, do you have any last words? The man said, what do you mean? He said, let it be. He cut off his head right there, and he died. Now the people of Kufa are even more terrified, because he said to them that he is going to kill them and cut off their heads. They thought that he wasn't that serious, but he showed them that he was serious. He kills without any hesitation. The ulama, they mention that Hajjaj and Yusuf, he killed just by himself in his lifetime around 700,000 people. Imagine Yawm al-Qiyamah, 700,000 people are going to come wanting their right back. Where is he going to go? Amongst those 700,000 are some Sahaba, some of the ulama, the Tabi'een, and some great people who are virtuous. Hajjaj bin Yusuf killed them. Didn't give it any thought. Killing was very easy to him. Forget that Hajjaj bin Yusuf almost killed his own father, because his father was against the stuff that he was doing. He said, if you were not my father, I would have killed you right here. But because you're my father, I'll let you live a little bit longer. That's what he said to his father. And anyone who's talking like that, I don't think mentally they're okay. Hajjaj, when he was in Iraq, he would make sure that the people of Iraq, they all come to salah. Anyone who would not come to the salah, he will punish them. Look at that, yani. Yani salah is taken very seriously. Whoever doesn't come to salah, they're punished. He would imprison them. He would whip them. And if it happens numerous times, he'll kill them. And his salah. He would lead the people in salah. Right? And because he knew the Quran very well. He was a Quran teacher. After his time in Iraq, during his time in Iraq, there was one of the generals of Bani Umayyah. His name was Abdurrahman ibn Muhammad ibn Ash'ath. Abdurrahman Muhammad ibn Ash'ath, he was sent by Abdul Malik ibn Urwan to conquer the lands of Khurasan. So he was successful and he had a huge army which were very strong and were not defeated. And they managed to conquer those lands. But Al-Hajjaj and Abdurrahman ibn Ash'ath did not like each other. Rather, they were arch enemies. Hajjaj used to belittle him and insult him. And Abdurrahman ibn Ash'ath used to consider himself better than Hajjaj. Right? And he couldn't tolerate Hajjaj belittling him. And also, Hajjaj was viewed by nearly everyone as a tyrant. Nobody liked him. Absolutely no one liked him. To the extent that Ibn Jawzi, rahmatullah alayhi, mentions in his book, Akhbar al-Hamqa wal-Mughaffaleen, that Hajjaj ibn Yusuf Thaqafi, one day, he was on a ship, and he had his men with him on the ship, and Hajjaj was not able to swim. A storm came, and Hajjaj went, and he fell into the water, and he started to drown. The men who hate him, his men, they rescued him immediately. Hajjaj was shocked by that. He said to them, why did you rescue me? You guys all hate me, even I know that. They said, we heard the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam say that the one who drowns is a martyr. We did not want you to be a martyr. That's how much they hated him. Huh? Al-ajeeb, huh? So that's how much he was hated, and he knew people hated him. It was no secret. And he didn't mind, he didn't care. As long as they obeyed him, he didn't care. He didn't want to be the popular one. So, whilst he and Abdurrahman Ash'ath, they had this feud, Abdurrahman Ash'ath, he managed to convince his army to rebel against Hajjaj. He managed to convince him. And when a lot of the other people in the other lands heard about Abdurrahman Ash'ath is rebelling against Hajjaj, some of the ulama, the tabi'een, joined Abdurrahman Ash'ath. And they fought alongside him. They said, this man, he's an oppressive man. We must get rid of him to save the Muslims from his mischief. And notice here, they never rebelled against the Khalifa Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. They rebelled against his governor, Hajjaj. Right? Amongst those who rebelled was Sa'id ibn Jubayr, rahimahullah. So what happened? Abdurrahman al-Ash'ath, his army was greater than Hajjaj. Hajjaj was losing. Then he sought reinforcements. And then when he got the reinforcements, he managed to defeat the army of Abdurrahman al-Ash'ath, and he managed to kill Abdurrahman al-Ash'ath. And all those who rebelled against him, he brought them one by one in front of them. And he said to them, admit what you have done is kufr. That you have disbelieved Allah. What they have done is not kufr, of course. Some of them were terrified of him, because they knew that he would kill them if they didn't admit it. So they admitted it and made a sikhas to save their lives. Others refused, like Sa'id ibn Jubayr. He said, no, I have not committed kufr. I stand by that. And if I was able to do it now, I'll still get rid of you, said to him. Hajjaj killed Sa'id ibn Jubayr, rahimahullah. And the killing of Sa'id haunted him for the rest of his life, because he killed him in a terrible manner. He cut him up. For the rest of his life, you see nightmares of Sa'id ibn Jubayr. Tayyib. Whilst Hajjaj is in Iraq, and he's done all this in Iraq now, Abdul Malik Marwan sends him to Hijaz to recapture Hijaz from Abdullah ibn Zubayr. What does he do? He first goes to Medina, he captures Medina. When he comes to Medina, he has towards Mecca. And he again surrounded Mecca. He done Hisar. There was a siege on Mecca. No one gets in, no one gets out. Nothing gets in, nothing gets out. And he catapulted the Kaaba. And a part of it broken. He's the second man who done that. Abdullah ibn Zubair fought against Hajjaj. And then they were no match for his army. A lot of the people of Mecca were scared of Hajjaj. Because they didn't have enough men. And they didn't have enough weapons and so on to face Hajjaj. So Abdullah ibn Zubayr, he faced him with just a few people. And a lot of those, and in the end, he fought it by himself. Abdullah ibn Zubayr, he went to his mother Asma bint Abi Bakr radiallahu anha. And she was blind, old in age at that time. He said to her, "Oh my mother, I'm going out to the battle. Forgive me for anything. And if I do not come back," he said to her, "if I do not come back, make dua for me." His mother, Asma, she felt his chest. She's blind. Why did she feel his chest? To check if he was wearing armor. And when she felt his chest, she felt that he had no armor on. And then she said, "This is my son that I knew. He does not fear death." So Abdullah ibn Zubayr, he went out and he fought fiercely against Hajjaj, eventually until he was killed. And then Hajjaj, what did he do? He crucified Abdullah ibn Zubayr and hanged him up in Mecca for everyone to see him, to make an example of him. His mother Asma bint Abi Bakr would come out and say, "Bring down my son, let us bury him." And he would refuse and he would mock her. Sahabiya, the daughter of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Look how evil he was. And he kept him up there for days. Until Abdullah ibn Umar, he saw him. And he cried. And Abdullah ibn Umar, he warned Abdullah ibn Zubayr from his fitna. He said to him, "Don't do this." But Abdullah ibn Zubayr did not listen. Abdullah ibn Umar, he looked at Abdullah ibn Zubayr. He said to him, he's looking at his body. And he said to him, "Ya Abdullah, I have warned you of this fitna. You didn't listen to me. And this is the outcome. May Allah Ta'ala have mercy upon you." And he cried because of the devastating state that he saw him in. After that, Abd al-Malik Marwan, he rewarded Hajjaj again. And he rewarded him and made him the governor of Mecca and Medina and Hijaz, that whole area. And he governed it for a while. He would lead them in Salah. Abdullah ibn Umar would pray behind Hajjaj to avoid fitna. Until Abd al-Malik Marwan came for Hajj. And the people of Mecca, they went to the Khalifa Abd al-Malik Marwan. They said to him, "We need to speak to you." And then Abd al-Malik Marwan, he said, "Okay, speak to me and my governor Hajjaj." They said to him, "We want to speak to you alone." So he accepted that. Why do they want to speak to him alone? They want to complain about Hajjaj. They said to him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, you have made Hajjaj the governor over us. And he's not befitting to govern Mecca and Medina. He's oppressive. He mocks those who are noble amongst us. He belittles those who are noble amongst us. He is one who's extremely aggressive. And we were patient with him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, in order to obey you, Ya Amir. Put someone else in his place. Abd al-Malik Marwan, he listened to them and he replaced Hajjaj. Hajjaj, when he was replaced, his last day in Mecca, he led them in Salat al-Fajr in the Haram and then he delivered a sermon. He said to them, Ya Ahl Mecca, I know what you have done. You have complained about me to the Khalifa. I'm aware of your shenanigans. But know that this is not the last of me. And you're going to see a lot more of me. And I shall be back. And then he left. When he left, he was placed back in Iraq by the Khalifa. When he was in Iraq, he remained there for a long period of time, governing it. One day, a young man entered Iraq in the city that Hajjaj is the governor of. And he saw the big buildings and so on that they have built and so on, living a very lavish lifestyle. This young man was from the Khawarij. So when he saw Hajjaj and where he was sitting, he recited an ayah, this young boy. He recited the ayah in Surah Shu'ara where Allah says, وَتَنْحِتُونَ مِنَ الْجِبَالِ بُيُوتًا فَارِهِينَ, that you carve from the mountains homes, living lavishly and comfortably. Hajjaj, when he heard the ayah from the Quran, he got excited. He said, Ya Ghulam, أتحفظ القرآن? Oh young boy, do you have you memorized the Quran? Now this young boy from the Khawarij was very eloquent. Hajjaj is eloquent, and so was this young boy, very eloquent. So what does he say? He responds to Hajjaj, he says to him, أَوَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ قَدْ تَكَفَّلَ بِحِفْظِهِ فَلِمَا أَحْفَظُهُ. He said, hasn't Allah tabarak wa ta'ala promised to do the hifz of the Quran, i.e. preserve it? So why should I do the hifz of it? He said. And he's saying your question is wrong basically. So Hajjaj, he changes his question. He said, أَفَسْتَحْكَمْتَ الْقُرْآنِ, have you perfected the Quran and you know it well? And then the young boy responded by saying, أَوَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ أَنزَلَهُ مُحْكَمًا, hasn't Allah tabarak wa ta'ala revealed it perfectly? Why do I have to do that? So Hajjaj again changed his question. He said, أَفَجَمَعْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فِي صَدْرِكَ, have you gathered the Quran in your chest? And he basically asked, have you memorized the Quran? The young boy responded by saying, He responded by saying, أَفَأَنزَلَهُ اللَّهُ مُفَرِّقًا حَتَّى أَجْمَعُهُ, did Allah tabarak wa ta'ala reveal it scattered so that I have to gather it? So then he said, يَا غُلَامُ أَفَاسْتَحْضَرْتَ الْقُرْآنِ, استحضر means that you place something behind your back and you know what it says. So the young boy responded by saying, مَعَذَ اللَّهُ أَنْ أَجْعَلَ الْقُرْآنَ وَرَاءَ ظَهْرِي, I seek refuge in Allah to make the Quran behind my back, i.e. not follow it. Hajjaj now got angry, he got frustrated. He said, وَيْحَكَ مَذَا أَقُولُ, he said, woe to you, what shall I say? He said, the young boy now is teaching Hajjaj, قُلْ أَفَوَعَيْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فِي صَدْرِكَ, have you done wa'i of the Quran? Now wa'i in the Arabic language, it comes from the word wa'a, and it also comes from the Arabic word wi'a. Wa'a means he understood. And it wi'a means a container that holds something, right? So he's basically saying that, does your heart contain the Quran whilst understanding and so on, right? Because one of the Sahaba, his name is Abu Umam al-Bahri, I believe, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُعَذِّبُ قَلْبًا وَعَى الْقُرْآنِ, that Allah tabarak wa does not punish a heart وَعَى الْقُرْآنِ, understands the Quran and contains the Quran, right? So Hajjaj said, خلاص, أفعلت القرآن? The young boy said, yes. So Hajjaj said, recite some of the Quran to me. So he recited, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح ورأيت الناس يخرجون من دين الله أفواجا. Hajjaj said, بل يدخلون. Allah said, إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح, when the victory of Allah and the conquest comes, and you see the people, the young boy recited what? يَخْرُجُونَ, leaving the religion of Allah Azza wa Jalla in big numbers, multitude numbers. Hajjaj said, rather they're entering us, the correct ayah. He said, لا بل يخرجون, the young boy. He said, no, they're leaving Islam. Hajjaj said, لِمَا, why? The young boy, he said, لِسُوءِ فِعْلِكُمْ بِهِمْ, because of what you're doing to them, they're leaving Islam. Now Hajjaj, he said to him, أَتَعْلَمُ مَنْ تُخَاطِبُ, do you know who you're talking to? The young boy, he said, Na'am, Hajjaj, Shaytan Thaqif. Then the Hajjaj said to him, Intabih, Sa'asfiku damak, Ihdar, be careful, I'm going to spill your blood. And then the young boy said to him, then what they say about you, what I believe about you will be true. And you just spill blood for no reason. So the Hajjaj, when he said this, he calmed down. He wanted to not do what he said. So then after he refused to, or he prevented himself from killing him, the young boy, he responded by saying to him, to thank him, يعني, بَيَّضَ اللَّهُ وَجْهَكَ وَأَعْلَى كَعْبَكَ. Now, if someone hears this, they will assume that he's making dua for you, the person is making dua for you. Because people use it as dua, right? بَيَّضَ اللَّهُ وَجْهَكَ literally means, may Allah tabarak wa ta'ala brighten your face, make it bright. وَأَعْلَى كَعْبَكَ means, may he raise your ankle, literally meaning, may he raise your status, elevate your status. But this young boy did not mean that, and Hajjaj knew exactly what he meant. He said, Hajjaj said to him, because he's very eloquent, he said to him, أَمَّا قَوْلُكَ بَيَّضَ اللَّهُ وَجْهَكَ فَتَعْنِي بِذَلِكَ أَنْ يُصِيبِنِ اللَّهُ بِالْبَرَصِ وَالْعَمَى. He said, as for your statement, may Allah make your face white and bright, you mean by that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala afflicts me with leprosy and makes me blind. And he said, as for your statement, O A'la Ka'bak, may he raise your ankle, you mean by that an uslaba wa u'allaq, that I'm crucified and hanged up. So he was cursing him, this young boy. So the young boy responded to Hajjaj by saying to him, قَبَّحَكَ اللَّهُمَّ أَفْصَحَكَ. May Allah Azza disfigure your face. Who's more eloquent than you? And this is Hajjaj Yusuf Thaqafi. He governed for a long period of time Iraq. And then eventually, he fell sick. And it said that he was afflicted with stomach cancer. He got stomach cancer, which prevented him from even going out. He was bedbound. And then when he got even worse on his bed, all his men were around him in his room. And then Hajjaj, he raised his hands. He said, Allahumma ghfir li fa inna an-nasa qad za'amu annaka la taf'al. So, oh Allah, forgive me, because the people have claimed that you won't forgive me. So the people around him, they said, Ahiya tawbah ya Hajjaj? Are you repenting from what you were saying, ya Hajjaj? He said, tawbah what? What am I repenting from? What have I done wrong? Yani, look how delusional he was. And then he said to them, take me to the majlis. To my majlis, yani, where he would receive his guests and so on. He was taken there. He said, لا يقول الناس أن حجاج مات على فراشي. He said, I can't have people saying that Hajjaj died on his bed. I have to die in an honorable state, he's saying. So they took him there. They carried him and took him to his majlis. He's sitting there. Then he told the one who has the best voice amongst them, recite Quran for us. So one of them started reciting Quran. And then, as he was reciting Quran, Hajjaj died. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, rahimahullah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says that I envy Hajjaj for two things. I envy Hajjaj for two things. Now the people said to him, you envy Hajjaj? How is that possible? This man was the worst of the worst. He has a record of killing 700,000 people, right? It's not easy. How can you envy him? He said, I envy him for only two things. They said to him, what are those two things? Number one, the way he used to treat the people of the Quran, he used to honor them. The people of the Quran, he used to honor them and venerate them and so on. That's number one. And number two, what he said before he died, right? And the way he died. Because the way he died, it seems like he died a good death. Right? And that's why he's so controversial. And that's why people are so confused about this figure. What is he? With this whole history of killings and killing such great people, but then also doing some certain things, which not many, a few things that are good. So they were confused. They didn't know what to say about him. And until this day, we are confused. He's like a character from a film. That didn't exist. It doesn't make sense. So bipolar. It doesn't make sense that someone could be like that. But he existed. And Abdul Malik Marwan, his reign carried on after Hajjaj died. And he eventually died. And then his son, Al-Walid ibn Abdul Malik, took over from him. In the next session, inshaAllah ta'ala, we're going to cover, inshaAllah, the rest of stuff that happened in the time of Bani Umayyah. And we're not going to cover all the Khulafa of Bani Umayyah, rather we're going to cover some of them, the most significant ones where the most incident happened in their time. InshaAllah ta'ala, we ask Allah. Today we covered a lot. I managed to talk about a lot, right? Because it's after Isha, so I dragged it on. But we ask Allah ta'ala to make us from those who hear this speech and follow the best of it. And we ask Allah ta'ala to make us from those who benefit from history. And we ask Allah ta'ala to make us from those who take lessons from it. Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi says that من قرأ التاريخ عاش الدهر كله. The one who reads history and learns from it, he has lived all of time, right? You have so much experience. There's so many things that happen in what we mentioned today. So many lessons that can be taken from them, right? We ask Allah to make us from those who take those lessons, inshaAllah ta'ala. If there are any questions, inshaAllah, we'll take questions. Barakallah.